activist in the food and environmental space. And we have Mr. Lakshman Nair, who is the director of BioBasics. And he was formerly the commander of the Indian Navy, and he was formerly associated with the Isha Foundation. And we also have Madhu with us, who is a digital content manager, and I think she graduated from Amrita University. So over to Ramesh Chandran, sir.
A very good morning to all of you. Namaskaram. Krishna Guharji is here. My respects to him and the rest of AVP, all the doctors and staff, and I'm told some patients are also here. So my thanks to AVP in general, Krishna Guharji in particular, for arranging this session, and also for giving us an opportunity to share our knowledge with all of you. We are also very pleased to collaborate with AVP because we completely identify with the philosophy that Rishi talked about prevention being better than cure. And we would like to do that. That's what we're trying to do in BioBasics, and we are happy to collaborate with AVP on that. So just to give you a quick introduction, we call this session Know Your Food, How to Get It Right. So we have been doing this session since 2015 when we started BioBasics. We've covered schools, colleges, Rotary clubs and other places, including hospitals, where we explain these concepts, share some of the knowledge, because some of us don't, although we know about the food system, we are not fully aware of the extent of the problem or the solutions that can come out. We are part of Ananta Charitable Trust, where the mission is to promote sustainability through social enterprises. So all of us are part of this trust, and we are promoting BioBasics as the brand so that consumers can recognize organic food and sustainable food as part of BioBasics. So this quick session that we have is basically half an hour to 45 minutes, and we're going to deal with three questions. The first question is, what is the quality of food that we have today? So all of us have had breakfast, I'm sure, but what is the quality of food that we have? So let us quickly look at what all we have eaten or what we regularly eat, at least in South India today. But before that, let's understand, when we say good quality food, let us understand what we mean by that. When we say that, many of us think that, okay, things should be fresh. The people think, you know, vegetables, etc. should be fresh, they should be tender, they should be tasty. Some of them say that, okay, well, it should be endorsed by celebrities, maybe a Sachin Tendulkar or a Vijay. When they say something, it's acceptable. Or it should be beautiful in shape and color. You know, we should have good color tomatoes or carrots and so on. And sometimes even they say, okay, great packaging will also help. But the simple point that we ask is, what about the safety of the food that you have? It may be fresh, but is it safe? Is a question that we ask consumers, we ask everyone, ask all of us, our families, is it safe? So when we go to the vegetable market, typically, we look for fresh greens, we look for fresh tomatoes, we look for fresh lady's finger or onions or something like that. But basically, do we ask ourselves, is it safe to consume? That is the fundamental question that we need to ask, which most consumers don't ask. So to us, good quality food means safety first. Freshness, tenderness, packaging, color, taste, etc. comes secondary, is what we believe. So let's look at some of these typical meals that we have. We have an idli dosa in the morning, typically in the south, where you can see it comprises of rice, dal, and other ingredients that we use. We also have during lunch, again, similar set of things that we have. During snacks, we again use milk, tea, coffee, that is also there, which we use quite regularly. And of course, dinner. So if you look at this entire range of 3 to 4 meals, and most of us eat at least 3 times, some of us eat even 5 times a day. But if you look at all that, you will find that we are using certain ingredients, and let us look at what these ingredients are. We'll see one by one what they are. So let's look at the white rice. What if I were to tell you that the white rice that you eat, that we all eat, is highly polished and it is chemically grown and chemically stored? So I remember as a child, my mother would give me a plate of rava to pick insects from. This is, I'm talking 30, 40 years ago. So as a child, I would pick them out. Today, you are buying rice or rava or anything that you buy. How many insects do you see there? Rarely do we see any insects. Why is it? Is it because the insects have changed their diet? It is because we have processed these rice or dal or wheat or whatever in such a way, with chemical contamination, we have kept out the entire insects and all that, which is, in a way, it is good. We don't have to consume insects. But the reality is that in the chemicals that we have added, those chemicals are directly going into your body and your system. Some believe that it is okay if you can wash the rice, it is okay. But there are, the chemistry has evolved over the last 30, 40 years that some of these are even dangerous, and we will explain how it is dangerous. So the other aspect of white rice, which is, if you can imagine, white rice is something that we eat almost three times a day, either as idli dosa or as awal or as rice or even kanji. We eat idli, this white rice, on a regular basis. Imagine that it's completely polished. So the essential nutrients which should be there in the rice, in the red rice, or which are available in semi-polished, unpolished rice, is completely taken out. And what we are eating is complete starch. So that is another part of it. If you look at dal, similar problem. You're fully polished, chemically grown, chemically stored. The fumigation that is allowed by the government is so high in some of these mandis, rice or dal mandis that you have, that you have tons of food lying there. And to keep the rodents and other insects in the mandi, you will allow, and the government has allowed, so much of chemical fumigation. And they use something called aluminum phosphate. They called Selfas. There's a tablet called, it looks like Odonil. You keep it somewhere there. It is highly poisonous to even human breath. But if you inhale too much of aluminum phosphide, you could die. But that is kept in the mandis. So to keep up, and this is banned. It's banned in several countries. But in India, we continue to use these aluminum phosphide to keep our rice safe from rodents. So this is what we consume on every day, three times a day. Look at the vegetables now. Most of us actually are concerned more about the vegetables. When we say going organic or having safe food, we are worried about vegetables. And vegetable cultivation, as many movies also in Tamil Nadu or Tamil and Malayalam also, many movies have come up where they are showing how the vegetables are dipped in chemicals, they are sprayed. I'll tell you a quick story here. In our land somewhere in Pollachi, the neighboring farmer was one afternoon was spraying some chemicals on his crop. And then when we asked him what is the chemical, he said some name, something like karate or something, some chemical is there. He says, what is it? Can you show me the pamphlet? He showed me the pamphlet. The pamphlet is in English. He cannot read English, but the pamphlet is in English. It clearly says that this chemical is to be used only for cotton. And what was he growing? He was growing the string beans, the karamadi that we call it in Malayalam, or the beans, the long beans. And the pamphlet also says that you should not use this before, you should use this only 21 days before your harvest, so that the effect of chemicals is less. And we asked him when he was going to sell this to the market. He said, sir, naalike dhaan porom. We are taking it to Kerala. From this Pollachi, he's just crossing over the border to Kerala, and he gives it. Why is he giving it like that? So he's giving you fresh vegetable, but he's also giving you fresh chemicals also. But why is he doing it? Because he says, sir, if I give these vegetables with a few spots here and there, I get only 8 rupees a kilo. If I give it clean with no spots, I get 12 rupees a kilo. So I will go and do this. This is what he said. And he's not a very educated farmer. But this is the kind of story that you see across the board. We have, in the last 4 years, we've been running this company. We have come across so many farmers who are forced to do this. Why? Because consumers like you and me look at tomatoes or beans or carrots and we don't want to even see a small spot. And the moment we see a small spot, we reject it. But what we are saying is, if there is a small spot on it, if the insects have eaten it, please understand that that is in some ways safer because the insects have eaten it. And they are possibly more intelligent than human beings at this point. So this is about veggies, which we are all concerned about. Fruits, similar situation. And FSSAI, the Food Safety Organization, also complains about this quite often. There are, when it comes to mangoes and when it comes to bananas, you have artificial ripening using carbide. So they are not ready to eat, but then they artificially rise using acetylene. They are ripening these fruits and they are made available for us. And who, we eat fruits for our health and it goes directly, some of these things go directly into our bodies. Now oil is one of the biggest culprits. We talk about refined oil. There are advertisements on TV on refined oil, on paper on refined oil. They show how transparent it is. All refined oil goes through an RBD process, which is called refining, bleaching and deodorizing. It's called RBD. You ask any food technologist, they will tell you. They have perfected the art of refining. And what do they do? Take out, by bleaching, they take out all the sediments and other things that they do. Deodorize it. Even they take, if they take coconut oil, they will take out all the, because they are doing it at a very high temperatures. So the smell will go away, one of the things. Secondly, the government allows that when you are selling coconut oil or let's say sesame oil or even groundnut oil, you need to provide only 70% of that oil as what you are calling it. So groundnut oil needs to be only have 70% groundnut oil. The rest 30% can be any oil which is allowed to be blended. So we are talking about linseed oil or the cottonseed oil or sometimes even palm oil. Palm oil is very useful. So they are blending it with the regular oil and they are producing it. So these are the problems with the refined oil that we have. And guess what? In the Indian cooking, we use oil for almost every dish that we prepare. Maida is another version of white rice, white form of wheat, where we take out the nutrients from it and it, what is left behind is highly only carbohydrates. So their excessive processing is there. Spices, they are chemically grown, no doubt. Things like cardamom, pepper, etc. High levels of contamination is there. And you have this and adulteration in some of these things, which is a lesser evil, but then the chemical use is the bigger problem. Then you have white sugar, which again we combine, we use quite a lot. All of us in our houses use. By some count, 54 chemicals have been stated to be used when you produce white sugar. So all this, when you have your cup of tea, you have sweets, use anywhere you use sugar, you're consuming these chemicals on a regular basis. Now, milk is one of the bigger culprits and we'll come to that, but it is contaminated milk is a matter of record by the government has submitted to the Supreme Court in 2011 that 68% of milk that is being produced in the country today is contaminated mainly by detergents and urea. This is a submission of the government to the Supreme Court. So it is not my statement, my allegation. So this is the standard of milk that we have. And milk is something that we very happily and forcefully we use, give it to our children. And then coming to tea or coffee, tea is one of the most acidic and very, if you go to a tea garden, the amount of chemicals being used to grow tea leaves and all that is very high. So much so that the workers in the tea gardens have to intoxicate themselves to be able to work with those kinds of chemicals. This is the level of contamination that happens. So as you can see, all this is leading to contamination. It leads to a poor health, which Devi will talk about. But if you see, there is also this our consumer mentality of chasing whatever is white. Maybe it is our slavish mentality, thanks to our British rule or whatever. We chase white things, be it in skin color or whether it is in white rice, maida, white sugar, white rava, even refined oil. We are not ready to take any sediments which you see cold pressed oil, if you see, you will see sediments. This is natural mm-hmm. thing, which our parents or our grandparents were used to, but we have stopped using it. And so much so that even the humble salt that we use today has been demineralized, and you add iodine in it, what it should provide you, a typical table salt or rock salt or whatever, what it should provide your human body is not being provided by the salt that is available in the market today. So in effect, what we are saying is the contamination levels are high. Now, I am not even talking about processed food, which some of our children are addicted to, ranging from kurkure to cakes or whatever, biscuits and other things that we have. This whole set of additives are added on to any packet. In fact, Devi had done a session in one of the schools where she asked the children to bring packets, you know, empty packets of biscuits or cakes or bread and all that. And we asked them to read the additives which are there, which are ingredients which are there. And you will find all these ingredients named, very nice names. You know, you have something like acidity regulator, or you have enhancer, flavor enhancer, and things like that. Don't get fooled by these names. These are very nice names, but they are all chemicals. And they are chemicals which are, there are about 555 chemicals or additives which have been approved by the government for processed foods. And if this is what is going on as a part of regular eating, so you buy anything which is in paper or plastic from the store, this is, you read the ingredients list, they are listed in the order of the maximum volume, the order of volume. So the first thing you might see, even in a Cadbury's chocolate, if you see, you will see the first or the second thing would be sugar. It is not cocoa, it is sugar. If you take a bread or a biscuit, you will find the first ingredient, which means the maximum volume. What is it there in a bread or a biscuit? Maximum would be either a maida or wheat flour. They will never say whole wheat flour, it will be maida or wheat flour. And if you see the list, you will find even things like vegetable oils listed. Now, vegetable oils are something is there. You know, basically it is talking about either palm oil or some of these cottonseed oils, what they are talking about. So these are numbers which are given, so they don't have to list out the name of the chemical. So you will find E numbers. In Europe, they find E numbers. In India, you find INS numbers. So it will be INS 621, which means it is an acidity regulator, which means it is a chemical. So this is what is being sold to us and we consume on a daily basis. Now coming to milk, which is something this is the adulteration, milk adulteration, food safety report in 2011 said 68% of milk that is produced in the country is contaminated. And which are the main contaminants? They have urea. Urea is added by the farmer level itself to give thickness to the milk. Because why? Because the consumers like to get thick milk. And the strange thing is the cow doesn't produce the same level of thickness of milk all through its period of its entire 9 month or 10 month period post lactation. So it never produces that. But why? The consumers are demanding that we need thick milk. They think that thick milk means it is a lot of fat is there, very good for us. But how do you produce it like that? Consistently, you add a little bit of urea. If you want it to foam, you add a little bit of detergent. Now this is what is happening across the board. In fact, yesterday I was seeing a news item, which I have not discussed with my team also, is that in UP, there are two people have actually become crorepatis, making milk out of shampoo. Just imagine the amount of adulteration right under the nose of the government. So unfortunately, this is the contamination in the food system. So the problem is we are not eating food. We're eating food-like products. The photograph here is of something like a kurkure or something equivalent, where you just ask yourself whether your grandmother knew what kurkure is. We wouldn't have known. But we are eating these things regularly. Children from school, they come and buy these 5 rupee packets of kurkure or Lays or something like that. So this is the level of food safety today. In our view, if you look at across the products, I have not even talked about animal products, which is meat or mutton and those kinds of things. I have not talked about that. But if you look at the entire range of products we are eating today, most of them have chemicals, if not all of them. Some of them are adulterated, some of them are overprocessed, like oils, wheat, rice, etc. So this is the level of food safety today. So what is the quality of food today? We say that it is not even bad, it is worse than bad. And that is what we believe. So we would like to expose all of you to some of these things. Some of you are doctors here. We would like you to kind of ask questions. The way we have structured this presentation is, I will hand over to Devi now, and she will talk to you about how this food is affecting our health. So that is all the bad news that Devi and I will carry. But the good news that I will leave for Lakshman to carry is to tell us how, what we can do about it. All this is going on. How can we change? What can we do? So with that, I hand it over to Devi. Before that, I will introduce Devi. Has been working as an activist in the food and environmental space for over 15 years now. She is part of a couple of campaigns. One is the anti-GM campaign, genetic modification campaign, where they are trying to introduce genetic modified seeds. So they tried it with brinjal. Now they're trying it with mustard. They're introducing genetically modified seed, which is harmful for human health as well as animal health, as well as the agro biodiversity of the country, on one hand. She's also involved with something called Save Our Rice campaign, which is about protecting, conserving the traditional varieties of rice. India had over 1 lakh varieties of rice. Today we are eating only Sona Masoori or Punni. Only 2 or 3 varieties we are eating, partly thanks to the Green Revolution. But my point is that there's a lot of effort going on from Devi's point of view and the organizations that she works with, where they're trying to resuscitate some of these varieties in such a way that people like us can consume and farmers can grow. Only when that ecosystem works, only then these rice varieties can be conserved. So I'll now request Devi to talk about the rest of the presentation.
Which one? Namaskaram. Like Ramesh said, it's all bad news in the morning, but well, there is always hope. So continuing what Ramesh said, okay, what does it do to our health, what we consume? Because you know, there are particular aspects now when we see modern day evils or, you know, health problems which you are encountering day in and day out, we have a tendency to believe, we would like to believe it is all genetics. But the thing is, most of our grandmothers were doing very well indeed. They were not suffering from any of this, and most of them into their 80s have worked in farms, have worked in homes. So why is it that we who are their progeny, we are not able to do it? So what is it that current day food system, the current day pollution levels, what is it doing to us, is the question we have to think about. So out of these chemicals, so like I said, we talk about genetics, we say modern day life is full of stress, we have environmental pollutants, and we have lifestyle issues. So most of us like to address the lifestyle issues. We start running, we start going to the gym, and then we think that, you know, our stress, which is unavoidable, is going to harm us. But we don't look at two important factors. One is our diet and one is the environmental pollutants. So when we say environmental pollutants, it is not only like we say it's out of our control, but even our homes, even our personal use material is full of chemicals, be it the perfumes we use, be it the cleaners that we use today, be it, you know, what we use in our home to freshen up the home, or what we use in our gardens, everything is, you know, with chemicals. And we do have natural alternatives. But the thing is, chemicals have become so part of our existence that we don't even see them. They have just become invisible. So when we see an insect in our food, people are horrified. We immediately say, oh, there is an insect, poochi irukku. But we don't see the invisible chemicals in our food. We don't see the invisible chemicals all around us. We breathe it in, our skin absorbs it, our bodies take it in through every pore that we have. And who are the biggest sufferers of this? It is women, children, and the aged. Because these are the vulnerable populations. So children, as we see it, I mean, one of the classic cases we have seen in Kerala, some of you are from Kerala, is the Endosulfan tragedy that we saw, which happened because of the, you know, aerial spraying of the cashew plantations in Kasaragod with Endosulfan. And 10 years of it, they started noticing problems with the population. There were miscarriages, there were deformities, there was cancer, there was mental retardation, and host of illnesses, which the authorities refused to accept. They said, no, it has nothing to do with Endosulfan. And, you know, one of the things which we always say, look at this girl. The deformity that she has, it's the same that the cattle has. So many instances, my activist friends who were working on this, they found that these deformities, it took them years to convince the authorities that Endosulfan had caused it, which led to the global ban of Endosulfan. The tragedy is the biggest problem that Endosulfan spraying has caused was in India, but in the global arena when it had to be banned, the only country to oppose the ban was India. We did not want to ban it. So, I mean, what are we looking for? Shouldn't we be looking at the children of, I mean, the health of our future generations first? I mean, what we do, isn't this for our children? And we Indians are the ones who talk the most about loving our children, sacrificing our lives for our children. But, you know, our actions, it's all in words, but in our actions, if we see, we are harming them. We are harming the very basis of our existence by using these chemicals so rampantly in our lives. And now, when we are progressing, with so many fronts, we are making progress. We are also making progress on fronts which are not very desirable. And as doctors in AVP, you are of course encountering so much of illness. You know, India is becoming in some ways the diabetes capital of the world. We have such high incidence of diabetes, and we think it is genetic factors alone. It is not. Even in India, I mean, there are studies abroad. India, in Madurai Kamaraj University, they have linked, diabetes to the use of pesticides. Directly linked that pesticides are causing the incidence of diabetes. And cancer, of course, now, like yesterday, somebody I met was saying that we were at a dinner. She was saying, you know, okay, what do I have to do to go organic or whatever? She said, you know, every third person I meet, she's in her 50s like me, and she was saying every third person I meet is talking about cancer, either for themselves or for some member in the family, which was something uncommon. Even 25 years back, cancer was spoken of in hushed whispers, but we see it rampantly, and chemicals are directly linked to the incidence of cancer. And something as simple as obesity, I mean, let's forget the big things like cancer and diabetes. Obesity is something which is everywhere. Interestingly, I think it was about 20 years back when we moved to US, what struck us first was the amount of obesity. And when we went from India, I mean, it was not a crisis in India. And when we went to US, we were in the Midwest, and we saw so many obese people. And it was so shocking for us, because we go from India to live in the US, we think it's the, you know, the most developed nation in the world. They have figured it all out. And then you see obesity and you wonder, where have things gone wrong? And then that is how I got into working on food and farming, seeing this obesity crisis. And what was shocking is, after our stint abroad, when we come back to India now, we find that the crisis has come to roost here as well. It is not something that only the West has, but it is here. It is here for all ages. And it is not like people are overeating, or, you know, people have no control over their diets. Obesity is made into a personal problem where people are told it's because you do not have discipline, you're obese. But it is what is in our food. It is not the quantity. It is what is in our food, what it comprises of, that is leading to obesity. So instead, we penalize the individual by telling them that they are not disciplined enough, which is not the case. So when it comes to pesticides in food, there are five myths. We think that, okay, I mean, these things are being, now, you know, she's talking about pesticides, but I'm sure, you know, we have regulatory bodies to take care of all this, and what is released into our system, you know, should be safe for us. We think it is rigorously tested. The testing of pesticides or chemicals is only for the active ingredient. So a pesticide might contain three or four elements. One is the active ingredient and the others are additives, you know, adjuvants which make it stick. It's only the active ingredient which is tested. The second thing is, when you eat three items which have been sprayed with three different pesticides, it is not the combined effect of these three that is being tested. It's only one, I mean, each ingredient which has been separately tested, and you know, the industry arrives at whether it is within, you know, the maximum residue limit which is permissible, or within the, you know, limits of average daily intake allowed. But it is not taking into account the fact that these three chemicals are going into your body the same day. So there is a major lacunae. Second is, all this testing is on adults, not on children. And children's bodies are much more vulnerable, much more fragile. They are growing very quickly in a very short span of time. Their hormonal system is very fragile. So the impact on children is not tested the world over. Europe being the only exception which has much more rigorous testing methodology, who have taken into account, you know, the combined effect and the cumulative effect of pesticides. The second thing we think is, it's very small amounts. You know, it's, you know, you have these labels, like he said, in English, which says that how much of pesticides can you use. But as we know, it is, the labels have nothing to do with the actual level of use. We use whatever, you know, is convenient. And in most villages or wherever chemicals are used, it's the pesticide dealers who tell the farmers, you know, idu apdiye idu rendu mix panni adichirunga. I don't know how rampant it's in South. In many states, the dealers have started mixing up different pesticides, making cocktails of it, because they find that the single pesticide is not effective anymore. So think of the, you know, the cocktail. It's not even the allowed, you know, legal or tested cocktails. It's just being mixed up. So the very small amount is, it's truly a myth. We don't even know what is the amount which is being used and how often, or how, you know, just before your, you know, when you consume it, it's being used. Third is, we believe that modern day pesticides compared to older chemical formulations break down quickly. We think that within, you know, 24 hours of it reaching the soil, it reaches its half-life, or 36 hours. But it doesn't break down. It does not disappear. It stays. It stays in the air. It stays in the soil. It stays in the water. Today, the situation is so bad in Tamil Nadu that farmers who use river water are not being given organic certification. Can you imagine that? I mean, they have to use borewell water because the rivers are so polluted. They say that if you grow your crops with river water, we cannot certify it as organic. I mean, that is a fundamental resource in nature which you're supposed to use. Surface water is definitely better than hard water that you get under the ground. But it's become so unsafe, the organic farmer is penalized today. He's not allowed to use it. The fourth thing is, we think we have reliable regulatory authorities. See, the regulatory authorities are very small bodies with very few people and resources. There is not much money. There are no huge labs. And most chemicals the world over are tested by the manufacturers. They give the test results. They submit the chemical for approvals. So, I mean, there is this huge case going on of Monsanto's, where one of their chemicals has been proven to be cancer causing. They have thousands of pages of reports, and there they say some of the tests had showed deleterious effects, but the company had taken away those results. So there are tests which simply are removed from the sample, and then these are approved. So based on the test reports, it's checked, it's approved. And then we believe the biggest myth is that pesticides are required for farming. Oh, we have to produce food. We have 1.3 billion people. How do we feed them? India has known traditionally to feed its people without using a chemical, single chemical. So we did have a crisis, you know, post the independence. What has happened is, during the British era, our food farming had been shifted to commercial crop farming. So farmers were moved from food into jute, into cotton, into indigo for trade. So food farming had gone down, and post independence we had gone into the Green Revolution, which was highly chemical intensive farming. At that point, the government felt that we needed to do this Green Revolution farming to feed the people, but it should have been only a temporary solution. And we should have gone back to more, you know, the jaivik kheti, irkai vyavsayam, you know, we should have gone to the more sustainable thing in the long term, because we do have the capacity to produce it naturally. But what we did was we continued with the chemical situation. And what is the result of that? We have 2 million farmers who recorded instances where they have abandoned farming. Children of farmers do not want to become farmers. In the village where we have land, there's not a single person below 35 who's on the land. Not a single person. No young people. All the young people want to drive tractors and JCBs, but nobody wants to work on the land because there is no social prestige associated with it. There is no money associated with it. Water, as we know, is a crisis which has gone, it's going out of our control. So many of our farmers are unable to crop, you know, grow crops during many seasons because there is no water. And many of them have bore wells which are going to 1,000 feet. That is what they do. And one of the results that we have seen is unimaginable levels of farmer suicide. A suicide is a desperate act of a person who feels he has no more choice. It is not an easy act. And in the recorded time, since 2004, since NCRB started recording farmer suicides data, and I have been the group that I'm associated with, we've been working very closely in Vidarbha, where it's the hub of suicides. The figure has crossed 3,10,000, the recorded figure. This is after we have massaged the data, where we have changed the definition of farmer, where the farmer's son is not treated as farmer, where we have changed the definition of suicide. And the cause as well, we are questioning, saying that the cause of suicide is depression. And one of the proven side effects of chemical use is depression. So again, it all stems from the crisis, the huge agrarian crisis we are facing. And on in Punjab, which is the Green Revolution which fed India, where, you know, the Green Revolution took birth, the saddest thing is the instance of cancer. And day before yesterday, it was being said, I saw a news report that it is not linked to pesticides, is what we'd like to claim. But the incidence of cancer in Punjab is so high, it's unimaginable. I have colleagues who work there. It is so common. It is so common to have, you know, cancer. And in Bikaner in Rajasthan, you have a free cancer hospital. And there is a train which goes from Bhatinda to Bikaner, which is called the Cancer Express, because almost everybody who travels in the train is a cancer patient or a family caregiver. This is the tragedy of the people of the country who feed the whole country. In Punjab, you have wheat shops which say that Gehu, Jharkhand say, because people do not want to eat the wheat of Punjab. They want to eat Gehu wheat from Jharkhand or Madhya Pradesh. You have some, you know, signage saying that the Gehu is from Jharkhand or MP. So we have to recognize that we cannot delink the food, the environment, to the health crisis that we are seeing. And it's not only the health crisis, it is also a crisis of farming, it is a crisis of environment, and it's affecting human health. So it is for us to think whether this fundamental source, we need to relook at the whole food system so that, you know, we can find solutions, we can look at preventing the crisis. So, like Ramesh said, we know the effect on health is huge. And what I would like to say as an activist who's worked on farming, it's not only the health crisis that disturbs me, it's a crisis of your livelihoods, it's a crisis on environment, which, you know, I mean, I am appalled. I wake up when this climate, the whole climate change struggles are going on, and children who are fighting the climate change issue, one of their posters says, "You will die of old age, I will die of climate change." And as an adult, I feel ashamed that my children have to say and stand publicly with posters like that, and that we have brought things to such a stage. Thank you. But having said that, it is not without hope. It is not too late. we can do something about it, and that's what I think Lakshman will talk about.
Namaskaram to everyone. So to take this presentation forward, we've seen all the negative side of the whole thing, all the bad stories, all the uncomfortable things. I'm just reminded of a similar presentation that I did in one of the corporate offices, where they had scheduled this meeting during their lunch break. So people were having their food and we were talking about all this. And in the middle of their food, they were almost like looking at it and saying like, oh my God, like this is what I'm eating. So let's now look at what can we do about it. Is there something that can be done? Very little, lot. Let's look at it. So the first and most basic thing, you know, in the course of whatever Ramesh has said, we would have realized this is such a simple thing, no? Very simple thing to do. Just do not eat what our grandmothers will not recognize as food. It's a very, very simple basis to take. Ramesh was talking about the kurkure and all these things. It's a very simple thing to just look back. Did our grandparents ever recognize these things? If not, maybe we should relook at it. So, what biobasics we are talking about is not just organic food. We are talking about organic whole food. Right, in the beginning what Ramesh said, that the processing of the food, one is the chemicals in the food, the other part is the amount of processing that's happening. So if we look at the options that we have, you'll realize that there are options of organic whole foods that is available across the categories. Across all categories there are options available. Where no chemicals are used, 100% it's possible. Where it is pure and minimally processed, so many things are possible. Okay, today these things are available today. So I would encourage all of you to start looking at not just this organic, but organic whole food. So how can I go organic? This is a very simple question. I mean, an obvious question. Okay, what do I do next? From biobasics point of view, what we say is that the first thing that we want people to recognize is how to be organic. When we are saying being organic, we will look at it, and then buy organic. So before you buy organic, we feel that there are certain steps that you should take about what can I do about understanding the problem. So let's look at that. So first thing is to understand that safe food is the first priority. We are not looking at things like how attractive the food looks, how well it is packaged, or which celebrity has endorsed the whole thing. We are saying safe food. Are we getting safe food? That's the first thing to look at. The next thing is we are saying eat local and seasonal. See, today you look at it, look at the reality of today. We are getting almonds and apples from US, okay? Kiwi from New Zealand. And we are saying that we want to eat all this stuff. Should we not relook at whether we need to move all this all over the globe? See, there is one price that we pay in not eating local and seasonal, because of course, as Ayurvedic doctors, you will definitely recognize how important it is to have something in the right season and something that grows in that place. But there is another angle to it, which is an environmental price that we are paying in transporting this across the planet. There is, I don't know if you are covering it in this, there's a thing that we call about virtual water. Okay, there are another concept called food miles. So virtual water is, suppose we are exporting some food from here to, let's say, cashews or whatever we are growing here, we are exporting it to US, millets or rice, we are exporting it to the US. Effectively, we are exporting so much quantity of water there, because there is so much of water that has been used in this place to grow this food. We are exporting it. The second is the food miles. Food miles is the amount of distance that the food moves. If you calculate it in miles, it's so much of energy is used, whether it is by ships or by aircraft or whichever way that we are transporting, so much of energy is used. So therefore, this local and seasonal is a very, very important aspect. Again, in the context of seasonal, we tend to, you know, want to have mangoes in winter, okay, or we want to have watermelon in winter. Why? Why can't we enjoy the fruit that is available in this season at this time and eat the fruit or vegetable that's available in the other season at the other time? So understanding that when you're talking about quality of food, it is safety that we have to look at. Quality is, again, as I said, it's not about looks. It's not about, you know, how clear it looks and the whiteness, and those are not quality. It's whether the food is safe. Ramesh spoke about, again, we are reiterating it, accept ugly foods. Food that does not look good, if there is a poochie in it, all we need to do, vegetables, brinjal, you know, typically we will find, if it's organic, no, you will find that there are insects in it. All we have to do is to cut out that portion, use the rest of it. We've been doing it, like if I look at back my grandmothers, your grandparents, I'm sure they've been doing it and you must have seen it in your own lifetime. Can we not bring these things back into our life? Simple things. Then, understanding that bugs knows best. Okay, what we are saying is that if there is a poochie in the food or insect in the food, it is probably an indication that there is less chemicals. I must tell you a very beautiful story which one of our customers a few years ago narrated to us. So this customer has been our customer and she had picked up bananas, organic bananas from us. And she had picked up bananas from the market. And in her backyard garden, she had grown, I think, Sitafal. So these three things, she had kept it in her kitchen. Night, one rat has come into the house. The rat has eaten the organic banana and the Sitafal. It's left the chemical banana behind. Okay. So what we are saying is that there is, these creatures, they have a much better wisdom than us. Okay. So respect that. Bugs know best. Then Devi, she spoke about the agrarian crisis from the farmer's point of view, farmer suicides. Why should a farmer reach a point where he has to commit suicide, right? So the question to ask ourselves is, are we paying a fair price for our food? Are we paying our farmers well? See, if you look at the whole current system of how we are getting our food, the price that most of us are paying in the market for, let's say, tomatoes or any food you take, if you trace back and look at what did the farmer get for that same product, it's a pittance. I'm sure you've seen newspaper reports where you've, you know, there's a farmer on the street where he is selling bananas on the street for 1 rupee a kilo. It's a very sad state. There are so many reports where the farmer doesn't even harvest his tomatoes because it's so expensive for him to take it to the market. Market is selling for 50 paise a kilo. He's saying, I'm better, I just run it into the field here itself. So these are things we need to look at. Are we paying the farmers well? So the other context, no child of a farmer, sir, please. So the reality is that no child of a farmer wants to take up farming. Is that a good sign to have? We just believe that, you know, we have money, we can throw money around, go to the shop, put money and get the food that we want. It's not going to be a reality. Probably in the next generation, they will not see this as a reality. Somebody has to grow the food. It just doesn't grow by itself. We need to recognize that. So it's very, very important that we recognize that we have to ensure that the farmer is paid well. Then care for Mother Nature and Mother Nature will care for us. We are seeing this whole thing about right from climate change to the endocelphan issues to so many cases where we have abused Mother Nature and it's hitting back at us. Look at the number of cyclones that are having. Floods in Kerala and drought in Tamil Nadu. This is all because of the abuse that we have done over the just last two generations. More so in this generation. Other thing, keep it simple. Avoid technologies. See, today our reality is that refrigerator and today microwaves and more kind of gadgets are coming into our life and we are working using that to manage the food, right? We are saying that it's better to keep it simpler, okay? Wonderful it would be if you could just go to our backyard, harvest everything fresh and consume it immediately. Today in our city situation, this is not a reality, okay? But to a certain extent in biobasics, we are able to bring it closer to you that we are reducing the time from which the harvest happens and the food comes to your table. Okay, but look at for these options so that we minimize the amount of storing, processing, this, that, all these things that we do. Start a kitchen garden. It is something that there are many reasons to do it. One basic reason is that only when we actually try to grow food, will we actually realize the difficulty that is involved in it. how difficult it is. What is it that, you know, we feel that, oh, it's not looking good, just throw it away in the market, no? We, oh, this is not looking good, discard it. But only when we actually grow it, we will know how difficult it is to grow just that one tomato or something for it to come. That is one. Second is, there is a lot of evidence today, scientific evidence, where there is therapeutic health. They say that, you know, putting your hand in the soil actually addresses depression issues. Okay. So, there are multiple angles to it. And the third angle, of course, we can't cover our entire range of our food requirement, but whatever little is possible that we grow it, we know for sure that it is safe. We know for sure that it's chemical free, right? So there are multiple reasons that it's very nice to start a kitchen garden, right? Okay, and as consumers, it's our responsibility to take it up with the government and tell them that we want safe food. Unless we ask for it, the government is not going to do it. How can I buy organic? So it's important that, see, the basic question that many people have is, now how do I know it is genuinely organic? So on all this, what have we done? We have relegated the responsibility of whether we are getting safe food or not, either to the government or to the farmer or to the retailer or to the brand. We have to ask questions. We encourage all our consumers to ask questions. Please ask whoever is your retailer, wherever you are buying food from. Where is the food coming from? Does he know where it is coming from? Does he know the farmer? Do we have opportunities to go and meet farmers to look at what they are growing, where the food is coming from? The other thing is, go organic across all food items. So you must have realized in the first part of the presentation that it is not just fruits and vegetables that are contaminated. The contamination and the chemical addition and adulteration is happening across the board. So we encourage all our consumers and all people whom we talk to that it's important to go organic for all food products, not just select fruits and vegetables. It's not good enough. So, as we said, there are cereals, there are organic pulses and legumes, nati sakare, a fantastic alternative for sugar. It's in powder form, cold pressed oils, everything is available, right? And in terms of the cereals, the kind of work that Devi and the Save Our Rice movement is working on is such a phenomenal effort to recreate and preserve the biodiversity that existed once upon a time. And unless we as consumers choose those kind of rices, why should the farmer grow the rice, right? So it's very important for us to choose so many traditional varieties of rices rather than some standard thing or some improved variety of rice or pulses or fruits. It's true for everything. So care for safe food and not cheap food. Most of us, see, we are willing to pay a price for so many things in the market. But when it comes to food, no. We want cheap food, right? So we should care for, is the food safe? That's the first question to ask. So having said all this, where would you say, what is it that we can do? We feel that there is a lot that can be done by each one of us. BioBasics, as an initiative, we have started it 4 years ago. Now we'll be almost 5 years in Coimbatore. Now we are in the process of expanding it to other cities in Bangalore, Chennai, etc. We are going to be expanding. So it was initially started by Ramesh and Devi. I have joined it in 2015, I joined BioBasics, and we now today see most of our outreach of BioBasics that we have done is by events like this or by word of mouth. We have not like actively advertised in newspapers or, for that matter, the social media and all we have been doing only recently. So I said that it's since 2015, it's a social enterprise. See, the entire focus of BioBasics that we've started off with, the people you've seen who are the people involved, all of us. We started it as a social venture. The focus was well-being of the farmers and well-being of the environment and therefore the well-being of the consumer. Of course, we are offering the entire wide range. There are some sample products there before, as and when you have the time before the presentation closes, please feel free to go and look at few of the products. We have 200 plus products, but there's a small sample here. It's very easy to order. We do not have a shop model. We are supplying across Coimbatore. through a direct-to-home delivery. So we operate through WhatsApp and phone and email. We have an app and, you know, online thing also. But for Coimbatore, we encourage people to just get offline. Okay, it's very simple. Two times a day, Wednesdays and Saturdays, we are delivering. And because of the model that we are doing, that we don't have a shop, we have a very cost-effective operation. Our wastage is less, you know, because, okay, I must tell you this, that vegetables that our consumers order, today is what day we are on? Tuesday, right. So yesterday our order closed. Today, yesterday night, the orders for the vegetables and fruits have been sent to the farmers. The farmers are harvesting, as we are talking now, the farmers are harvesting the vegetables and fruits. By today evening and night, it will all be brought into Coimbatore, it will reach our office. Tomorrow morning, we will pack it and deliver it. Okay, that's the model in which we are doing it. For, of course, the non-perishables, we have a larger stock, but that larger stock is also like a 15-day and 1-month stock. We do not store and keep like for 6 months and 1 year, we do not stock like that. There have been, Biobasics has been featured in the media for quite some time now. The Hindu Metroplus has, of course, covered Biobasics, I think, 2 or 3 times. And Devi is a columnist with Metroplus. So once in 15 days or once in a month, you'll find Devi's articles coming on something related to food. What is this? Dinamalar, huh? Yeah. So I'm poor. I'm sorry. I don't know Tamil. So this is a question that I would like all of you, I would like to leave all of you with, you know. Of course, you are doctors, but if you see from a consumer, an average person's point of view, they try to find out, okay, is the doctor reliable? How well is this good? All that research we do. For our children, what do? We want to put the child in a school. We will ask this question is, oh, how good is the school, teachers, this, that. But how well do we know our farmer? Do we take any effort in finding out anything about our farmer? It's such a basic thing. Every day, 3 times a day, we are eating food. Such a basic thing, but are we taking any effort towards that? So, again, this is not something I should talk to you about. Food is your medicine and medicine is your food. But if food does not become your medicine, then medicine will become your food. So, may the realization begin. Thank you so much. If there are questions, I'm sure there may be questions that all of you will have. Meanwhile, the other thing that I'd invite you to do is that we've got, if you find it of relevance and you would like to, you know, what shall I say, Biobasics, if you feel that we can help you, there is a registration form. We invite you to leave your numbers and your email address and name, fill it out on the form. Please have a look at some of the products that we are offering. As I said, there are whole foods. There are some very interesting varieties of rices and very interesting stuff. Please have a look. And I'm willing to take any question of yours. Any of us, I mean, one of us can address it, I can address it. Please. So, there are no questions? Please. Can I just give you a microphone?
Good morning to you. At one end, we know about the farmers committing suicide. We all are sad about it. And this has been happening because of multiple factors. One, of course, is the water scarcity and the kind of cost that the farmer would receive at the end of selling the product. But at the other end, due to certain circumstances, there are fallow lands. So my question has been directed. Like today we have B2B Connect, B2C Connect, C2C Connect. Why is that? That, for example, you know, there are so many fallow lands wherein the landlords of these lands are looking forward that farmers to take up their land for harvesting and utilize it for the good purpose of cultivating food.
Right.
So what has been done on this aspect, sir? Thank you.
Probably Devi may have an answer for this in terms of what is being done. But the point I would like to make is that having seen how unremunerative it is to be a farmer, why should a farmer take up additional land and take up farming? You look at every which way, it is against the farmer. The climate is against him, water is not available, right? Even the market is against him. Every which way it is against him, they would like to look at moving out of any existing, what shall I say, existing profession to move on to some other profession which is more remunerative. Which is why today we have the situation that the children don't want to do it. Even the farmers are saying, please, I don't want my child to take up farming. You know, it's not just that the children don't want to do it, but the farmer himself is saying, I don't want my child to do it. Right? So that's one, answering only one half of the story. Ramesh, you have some answer? Yeah, so in terms of what is being done about it, I don't know. But in terms of organic farming, I would say that there is a phenomenal interest that is we are seeing, because we almost once a day we get a phone call. Once a week we get a phone call from some farmer saying that, look, I have organic produce, are you willing to take it? So farmers themselves are realizing it. By the way, most of us may not know this, that many farmers, they grow one set of food for the market, and what they eat for themselves, they have a separate patch. I don't know if many of us know about this. Farmers grow chemical-free stuff for themselves, but what they give to the market is something else. So, yeah, so that's as well as I think I can answer it. Whether the government is doing anything about the fallow lands, I'm not sure. Unless the government incentivizes farming in a big way, which the government is trying to do by way of crop insurance. I think now they've started out giving this, what shall I say, as an income for every farmer, they're giving it. They're trying to incentivize it. But on the organic farming side, unfortunately today, there is no incentive, which is again a disincentive, no? That chemical farming, there are certain incentives. For example, urea is subsidized. Some pesticides are subsidized. All this is there. But for organic farming, there is no incentive. So, there is some things being done, but not good enough.
Some farmers which are giving up farming is because it is not physical. What I mean to say is there are landlords, for example myself, you know, who are ready to support the farmer. So whatever the financial part of it, that would be taken care of. You know, we just need the manpower,
somebody to do
the
it.
Expertise to do it.
Right. So there may See, like you're as an individual, I have come across recently some newspaper articles in Bangalore. There are ventures who have started off, okay, as a company. They have started off things that they are kind of giving a connect for the urban user to the farmer. The farmer is being funded, like you're saying. He's being paid a salary or a certain mechanism to grow his food. He's allowed to stay on the land. And there is safe food being produced and the consumer is connected. So I would not say that nothing is happening. Government said perhaps not as much, but there are very interesting initiatives coming up. So, but yes, finding good people is really a challenge. I agree with you. Ramesh will also agree. Finding somebody good is really a challenge. So, if there are any other question, I would like to pose some two typical questions, very, very typical questions that we encounter. So, this I'm sure many of you will have it in your mind, but you may not have asked this question, right? Yes. So organic food is too costly. So let's look at it. There are two ways to look at it. I would say really so. We did a maths, okay, say where we did an analysis of how much does, if you switch to completely organic, we have not included milk in this, milk and milk products, but otherwise if you switch to completely an organic diet, how much more would you have to shell out? This, of course, data is about 3 years old. So small correction you can do to that. We found that a family of 4 people, if they switch completely to an organic diet, the excess amount that they have to spend is roughly 6 rupees per head per meal. Okay, it's slightly dated. Maybe today you want to take 10 rupees per head per meal, right? How much does one cup of tea cost? Easily 10 rupees, yeah? We have 3 cups of tea a day. Maybe you may not, but people do, right? So it's not really expensive. I would say that if you switch completely to organic, Our estimate is that it may cost anything from 3,500 to 4,000 rupees extra. The bare minimum basic organic food you can definitely get. Okay. And we have to contrast that against the kind of income that we generate in a month. The whole month salary, let's say, is our expenditure is about 20, 30, 40,000. In that, this extra amount, is it too much? Another point of view, compared to what? When we go to a doctor, right? Allopathic or Ayurvedic, when somebody goes for treatment, how much does it cost? Any test, straight away, 1,000, 2,000. We go to a mall, go for a movie. Yesterday, I happened to go with my family to see Lion King. Just three of us, we just spent 1,000 rupees just like that, right? We are willing to do that. But, or we go and shop, or we go and eat out. Eating out, many of us do. As a family, you go and eat out 1,000, 1,500 for one meal. Goes away. But we say that no. If I have to eat organic food whole month, 3,000, 4,000 rupees, that's too much. But this we will spend. So it's a matter of prioritizing. That's what I feel. Compared to, even branded products we go and buy. 3,000 rupees just like that, Nike shoe, 4,000, 5,000, we'll just pay. Right? Yeah. So this is a good thought. So if you're saying organic food is expensive, have we found out off late what is the cost of cancer for treating cancer? We'll be shocked. The other question, most common question that we have, how do I trust what is being offered? How do I know it's genuinely organic? To put the question in a different way, we should ask, right now the food that I'm eating, do I know how much chemicals is there? Do we ask that question? We don't ask that question, right? That, right now, what is MRL? Maximum residue level. How much should be the maximum residue level in my food? Do we ask that question? We don't ask that question. We should. Where does the food come from? Which farm does it come from? Do I know which farm it's coming from? Or what has been added to my food? Do I know what all has been added? What chemicals have been added? And if I don't know my farmer or my retailer, if I'm not bothering to ask, then why should the farmer care about me? If I don't care what happens to the farmer, whatever, I just need cheap food. Okay, why should the farmer care about me? These are questions that we should ask. But having said that, what we are saying is, so it's important to know our farmer, take some initiative. You know, from time to time, BioBasics, we offer farm visit. So we actually offer an experience where our consumers can go and spend a time in a farm. Meet the farmer, understand what the farmer is going through, what experiences, what negative, positive experiences he is going through. Ask for certification. See, certification is one of the routes that is there. It's not good, it's not fine-tuned yet. There are loopholes in it. BioBasics is now certified organic. But when we went into the certification, we realized that there are loopholes in it, which there are other players who are using those loopholes. But okay, to a certain extent, some processes will get put in place. We in fact have many products which cannot get certified simply because the process doesn't allow it. Very good, reliable organic farmers. One very good example. We have a turmeric farmer. In fact, one of the gurus of organic farming who trains farmers. His turmeric is certified for export. That means certification he's having for exporting. But if we take turmeric powder from him, that cannot be certified. You look at the irony of it. You'll wonder why, how can that be possible? Because the process of certification says that it's not just the farm growing which has to be certified, but the process has to be certified. That means which mill did he powder it from? Is that mill certified? Are there document exchanges that have happened? There are mandatory exchanges that are supposed to happen. The mill in a rural area, in a village, okay, which one mill which is powdering this turmeric or chili or whatever will be able to get it certified? So there are practical procedural problems in certification. There are some farmers of us, who are activists. They are saying that, look, you're telling me to prove that my food is certified or it's pure. The guy who's putting chemicals, you're not asking him a single question. Why should I do that? I will not get certified. So there are people like that also. So we have a mix of our farmers. But BioBasics from our side, we have our own mechanisms, our own evaluation process by which we satisfy ourselves that whatever we are offering to our consumers is genuinely certified. So unless that is done, we do not pick up anything from our farmer. Like I told you, every week we are getting a phone call from some farmer who will say that, yes, I'm having organic food, will you take it? So let me tell you 3-4 things that we are doing as BioBasics for how do we ensure that our food is certified. Is organic. Okay, so to ensure that our food is organic, what are the things that BioBasics does? First thing is that we look for a very reliable, known reference. Any farmer who comes, we look for a reference, whom somebody we can trust. So there is somebody else whom we know we can trust. Then that person refers this farmer, we say yes, one tick mark, right? Second is, we have a mechanism by which we have a what we call a field manager, and Devi herself, she does field visits. So unless we meet the farmer and interview the farmer, we do not accept any product from them. We have to visit the farm, see the farm, interview the farmer, understand what is the motivation of that farmer to grow organic. Until we satisfy that, we do not pick up. Third is, we insist on farmers being 100% of their land being organic. So there are farmers who have done part of their land organic, part is chemical. The thing is going on. We do not accept anybody like this. So 100% land has to be organic. Fourth, we encourage our farmers to go for certification. There are many farmers who cannot go for certification. You know, irony. Today, Tamil Nadu, or TNOCD, there's a department of government of Tamil Nadu, which is facilitating certification. They are, so farmers have gone in, they have signed up, they are certified. But the process of certification says that there has to be a transfer certificate that has to come from the farmer to me, saying that so much produce of certified product has come. The present government department doesn't have the wherewithal to give those certificates. So although they are certified, they can't even give certificates to us. You know, the transfer certificate cannot come. So there are many loopholes in this, but in spite of that, we encourage our farmers to go for certification. So these are some of the things that we do. Oh, questions is coming now. Okay, so I hope all of you had a, what shall I say? For me, when I heard all this for the first time, no, it was like very eye-opening. I was quite shocked. Okay, and I have seen that wherever I have made these presentations, people generally kind of are taken aback that, oh, this is the condition of our food. So maybe for some of you, you may have had this aha moment that, oh my God, like, oh, is it like this? So I hope it was productive for all of you. And we do look forward to a longer term relationship with Aryavedi Pharmacy. I think this is the first step, right? And we will see how beautifully we can take it forward. We are there to support you in any which way. We can work in multiple ideas that we have. I'm sure you'll have other ideas. We'll look at how to collaborate. And we'll of course would like to have the doctors here. In fact, doctors need to set an example. We feel so. So we would invite your doctors to, you know, become our consumers, and you know, we can support you in multiple ways. We can look at how we can support. So thank you very much. Thank you for this opportunity. On behalf of all of us at BioBasics, I wish to thank Aryavedi Pharmacy for this opportunity. Unfortunately, before KKG left, I wanted to thank him, but we'll probably go and meet him in person and thank him. Thank you. Namaskaram.